Good morning. How's everybody doing? All right, great to see you here this morning. Grab your Bibles if you would, please. I'm trying to recover from that last song. Anybody else with me? Man, that was powerful. Amen. Grab your Bibles if you would, please, and let's turn to Judges, the book of Judges. And there should be a Bible close to you there so that you can dig in with us. You'll get a lot more out of it if you'll dig in with us. And I want to tell you something else quick before we start. If you learn to dig into the Bible here while you're in church, you'll know a lot more about digging into it on your own later on. So take advantage of the time with us. The book of Judges is the seventh book of the Bible. So you're going all the way back to the beginning and just going up seven books from the front. Judges chapter 15 we'll be looking at. 15:1-5, and we'll be looking at verses 1 to 8. Judges 15, verses 1 through 8. As we get ready to dig into the Word, we're going to be talking about greatness, revenge, and gaining life. Greatness, revenge, and gaining life. We've been looking at the story of Samson. And, you know, some of you who have been studying with us probably have recognized that some of Samson's story reads a little bit like maybe some Western that you would watch on TV where, you know, you killed my brother, so I'm going to kill you, and now you're going to kill me. And it just kind of all reads like that all the way through the book of Samson. It's like a movie script, an action movie script. As we think about that, you know, some of us might react that way. We might feel that way in our hearts. Here's where we want to go. Listen to me very carefully as we dig in here. We want to be honest about where we're really at. We want to talk to God about where we're really at. We want to be honest with one another about where we're really at. And the fact is, let me ask you a question. How many of you have been deeply hurt in the past? How many of you wanted justice for that after you were deeply hurt? Stay with me. How many of you wanted justice? Somebody say, I did. We have that built into us, right? We want to see somebody pay. Amen? Let's be honest. We want to see somebody pay. Isn't that right? I don't know about, I want to beat the living daylights out of some people. Anybody with me on that? I mean, let's just be honest, right? That's what I want to do. So that's what we're talking about here. Maybe right now you're repulsed at what I just said, but the truth is, if you allow God to look deep in your soul, at some level you have some sense of desire for justice. God put that there. You have a sense of desire for justice. It may be more subtle than that. It may be like this. It might be like, okay, this person did some real evil, and I just don't want to see anything good happen for them. You know, so that's kind of a subtle way to approach the same issue. Amen, right? Anybody with me? Amen? Right? What about people that really, really, truly do something awful? What about really bad people? I mean, you know, what about some people who do some just serious evil and there's no question about whether that was somebody else's fault or not? I mean, it's just really, really evil what they did. How should we feel about that? How should we feel about that? What should we be doing with those kinds of feelings? I think we're going to get some help with some of those thoughts, some of those feelings today, some of the things that we struggle with in regard to that. Let's go back to Samson for a minute. Let me clue you in as to where we were last time we looked at him. Last time we left Samson, he had lost everything that he set out to gain. Samson had lost everything that he set out to gain. A woman, material wealth, status among the people. He had now looked like a fool. So Samson, what he had done was he had made a foolish, high-stakes wager, and he had made this wager with the guests of his own wedding. And so he kind of set them up where he was going to be the winner and he was going to gain a lot from this bet that he'd placed. The problem is that his wife betrayed him and caused him to lose the bet. He ended up paying the wager that was impossible to pay because it was so high stakes. He ended up paying it in blood by going and killing 30 people, taking all of their clothes and paying the wager that way. Instead of going back to his wife afterward, He was upset, of course, and so he went back to mom and dad, and the Bible says he was in hot anger as he went back to his mom and dad instead of his wife. Now, there's something that takes place when Samson goes back to his mom and dad that we need to talk about for a minute. So if you're in Judges 15, just take one step back to Judges 14 and verse 20 and notice just this verse. And Samson's wife was given to his companion who had been his best man. So what is being explained to us there is this. In his absence, as he had left the wedding, paid off the bet, went back to his mom and dad, without his knowledge, his wife was given to someone else. He didn't know what happened. He wasn't there. So keep that in mind as we pick up the story at Judges 15 and verse 1. Judges 15 verse 1. After some days at the time of wheat harvest, Samson went to visit his wife with a young goat. And he said, I will go into my wife in the chamber. But her father would not allow him to go in. And her father said, I really thought that you utterly hated her, so I gave her to your companion. Is not her younger sister more beautiful than she? Please take her instead. And Samson said to them, this time I shall be innocent in regard to the Philistines when I do them harm. All right, back to verse 1. First thing we see is the words, after some days. I would remind you that we've seen that phrase a few times in the Old Testament and in the book of Judges, and that means perhaps a year or more. So what's being said is that it's been a year or more since Samson went home to be with mom and dad and left his wife to do whatever she was going to do. So it's been a long time since the events of the wedding feast. Samson's hot anger seems to have subsided in this time period, and so he decides to pay a visit to his wife. And you're kind of struck with the question, did they actually get married? I mean, we don't really know if they ended up actually married or if they were just betrothed. We don't really know what the extent of the marriage was, but what we do know is this. According to Jewish tradition, they would be legally bound either way. And so that's why the Bible continues to call her his wife. According to tradition, she is his wife. She's legally bound to him. Now, apparently Samson knows, watch this now, he apparently knows that he's botched things up pretty good, because when he shows back up to visit his wife, he decides to bring a gift with him. You might notice that in the text, some guys bring flowers, right? Some guys bring chocolates. Samson brings a young goat. So that's it's a gift that's going to get him what he wants, right? It tops them all. Smart guy. So remember, guys, next time, no, anyway. All right, but here's the deal. A young goat is a curious, curious choice. Let me tell you why. Here's the reason that a young goat is a really strange choice. If you dig into Scripture, just note this and you can read it later on. Genesis chapter 38, back at about verse 15, explains to us that the gift of a young goat is actually the payment that is common for a prostitute. I'll let that settle in for you for a minute. So what Samson did when he came back to visit his wife was brought the exact amount that you pay for a prostitute. So it leaves you with the question, exactly what was it that he was saying? Was he trying to make things right with his wife? Was he trying to insult his wife? Was he trying to get into the bedroom? What was he trying to do? Anybody with me? After all, I want you to notice what he says next. I will go into my wife in the chamber, meaning that he intended to visit her in her bedroom. His intentions are pretty clear, is that right? Notice what happens next. Her father would not let him go in. Dad says, no way. Seems like a good dad to start with until you start kind of digging into the story and you see the way he reacted to this whole thing and what he was doing. He looks like an honorable guy until you see the rest of the story. First, he gives his reason for not letting Samson see his daughter. Verse 2, and her father said, I really thought that you utterly hated her, so I gave her to your companion. Now, in light of the way that Samson, or she had betrayed Samson, her father assumed that he would not want her, and that's reasonable, amen, right? You get betrayed, he thought, is that right? Make sense? Okay, that's reasonable. Notice the word hated. Did that stand out to anybody? Hated? Somebody say hated? That word is sana in the original language in the Hebrew. It's a word that is a word that stands out in the divorce laws that you read about in Deuteronomy chapter 24. The word hated shows up. Let me explain that to you for just a minute. Jesus explained this for us in Matthew chapter 5, and one of the things that he said about it was that the reason that Moses allowed for there to be a law where we could divorce our wives in the Old Testament is that guys were very often abusive to their women. And so because men were hard on their women, there was a way out. And that way out was divorce. And the word that explained that was this word sana, or the word hated. And so what you see this man saying, coming back to Judges 15, what you see him saying is, I really thought you were going to mistreat my daughter, so I gave her to somebody else. Do you see that? That's what he's saying there. All of that stuff makes sense, but here's what I need you to do. Everybody put on your mystery cap, your sleuth cap, and get your little deal out so that you can look at the fingerprints. Are you ready? Okay, there's a mystery going on here that you need to kind of dig in to figure out. Everything makes sense except for one thing. Why is it that she was given to somebody else so quickly? Why is it that she was given, his wife was given to somebody else so quickly? Now let me take you back for a minute so that you can think this through. Remember that Samson's companions at the wedding were part of her family. And one of those companions was the best man who she's been given to now. And also remember now that she betrayed Samson for those companions. So what's really going on here? Did she already have an interest in somebody else? Had they already decided they were going to get together when this took place? Looks like a soap opera to me, right? So Samson has some pretty good reasons to be angry. There's some stuff going on that he's not been told about. Anybody tracking with me? All right. You know, there's an interesting passage in Proverbs chapter 16, verse 34. Listen carefully to it. Somebody say, I'm listening. For jealousy makes a man furious, and he will not spare when he takes revenge. That's not God's approval for revenge. That's not what that is. What that is a statement by God, a wisdom statement saying, don't provoke somebody to jealousy because that's going to make a man more furious than anything else. Anybody with me? Nothing makes someone more angry. Jealousy hurts like nothing else. So you're thinking about that now and notice that her father is standing there at the doorway and he's explaining to Samson, your wife has been given to another man. To Samson, this huge man standing at the doorway, right? And he's telling him, hey, by the way, I gave your wife away to somebody else. And Samson's getting bigger as he makes excuses, right? He's turning into the Hulk in front of him. And no doubt as dad makes excuses, he can see this man, Samson, getting more angry and more angry and more angry right in front of him. So what does he do? What does the father do? He tries to make a little bargain with Samson to save his own neck. Look at the text. Is not her younger sister more beautiful than she? Please take her instead. Please take her instead. How many of you see there that this guy that seemed like a real stand-up guy is now treating his daughters like used cars? Right? It's like this. It's like the ad you see in the newspaper, that there's this one car that's such a bargain in Omaha, right? I mean, it's so cheap. Let me drive over there and get it. And when you get to the lot, lo and behold, they just don't happen to have that one anymore. But hey, we've got another one. Won't you please take this one? Mr. Used Car here, he's probably got on a plaid sports coat, right? Seems like Samson had put two and two together. He's figured some stuff out, and he is not happy. He is not happy. Now watch his response to the father and the daughter here at verse 3. Verse 3. And Samson said to them, so apparently the daughter's listening now too, his wife, this time I shall be innocent in regard to the Philistines when I do them harm. Now get a hold of that, because that is packed. Somebody say that's packed. There's at least three things there that I see that we can pull out of that, or we should pull out of that, so that we can understand some things about revenge. The first thing I want you to notice is this. Notice Samson's guilt. Notice Samson's guilt. Watch the phrase again. This time I shall be, what was the word? Innocent. What's he saying? In the past, I have been what? Guilty. Yeah. Notice how, now watch this closely. Watch this closely. Notice how God is warning Samson in his heart. Pay attention to that. Notice how God is warning Samson in his heart. Let me help you understand something about guilt. Guilt is not a feeling. Are you following me? Guilt is not a feeling. You may have been taught that it is. God's word says it is not. Guilt is not a feeling. You know what a feeling is that's associated with guilt? Shame. Shame is the feeling that comes from guilt. Guilt is not a feeling, it's a fact. Guilt is a fact. In other words, when you sin, watch this, when you sin, you have guilt. God built that in. God put that together. God allows you to have guilt. It's a fact. He puts it on you. The Bible talks about it like this, like it's God's heavy hand upon you. Anybody ever felt that before? You get the shame, right? And you're going, why do I feel like this? I can't get out from under this. It's so heavy. What is that? It's guilt. It's guilt. And it's a horrible thing to live under. And what do we try to do with it? We try to medicate out from underneath of it. We try to counsel out from underneath of it. We try to get somebody to tell us we're okay. But you know what the answer to guilt is? There's only one. Forgiveness. That's the only possible answer to guilt, is forgiveness. Guilt is a fact, not a feeling. And I must be forgiven that guilt in order to not be under it any longer. Somebody say, I get it. Come on now, do you get it? God put it in place for a reason, and we're not to ignore it. To ignore it, listen, listen. How many of you have been in a place you didn't want to be? You looked at your life and you said, okay, now I'm in a place where I didn't even mean to be. Don't even know how I got here. Anybody with me? How do you think you got there? Let me just tell you something very, very clearly and straightforward. It was called disobedience to God. And when you tried to live in that disobedience to God, you were under guilt and condemnation, you were under the heavy hand of God, and all he wanted you to do was to turn to him and give up your life for his. That's what he wanted. That's the love in what he's doing in guilt. The second thing that I want you to notice is this. It gets uglier as we go on. Premeditation. Notice Samson's premeditation. Notice what he says again in that phrase at verse 3. When I do them harm. When I do them harm. What's he doing? He's planning ahead to do them harm. Somebody say, I see that? Yeah. Now notice what that means as well. Notice that he has plenty of time to repent. What's repentance? It's turning and going the other direction. It's what guilt calls us to do, is repentance. It's I'm going this direction, God puts that guilt on me, I recognize it, I turn from that and I turn to him. Samson has all this time to do this because he's in premeditated mode now. Do you see that? He has time to rethink. Let me show you something. You think, listen to me, you think that when somebody's done you wrong, you have no choice but to live in that. You have no choice but to sit and think about how you're going to pay them back or how they're going to get it back. You think that's true. But let me show you something different. Let me show you a different path than premeditation. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 26. This is freeing. Watch this. God's word here says, be angry and do not sin. So I want you to notice the first thing that God does is gives you permission to be angry. Is anybody hearing me? The first thing he does is gives you permission to be angry. You need to understand something about anger. God gets angry. You can't read your Bible for more than 10 minutes before you find out that God gets angry. You think that Jesus is somebody different than God the Father? Jesus got angry. Jesus got angry. We are given permission to get angry. There's nothing you can do about getting angry. But there is something you can do about what you do about getting angry. Look at what he says. Be angry and what? Do not sin. Now let me show you something about this. One of the things that I've noticed about people who are maturing in Christ. See, some of you are sitting here believing that you're mature in Christ, and that's the worst thing that you can do. You think you're a mature believer. That's the worst place for you to be. You're putting on a show for everybody, acting like you're mature, but let me show you something about that. The more mature you are, the more you're okay with being angry. Man, that's the truth. I've seen that over and over and over again. People think when they first come to belief in Christ, they think, you know what, I can't act like I'm angry. I've got to put this away. I can't let anybody see that I'm upset. I've got to just be cool with everything. That's what a believer does. Mm-mm. No, just ask anybody that's close to me if I get upset. Listen to the people laugh in here that know me. You can tell when I'm mad, and there's probably things broken. But anyway, you can tell when I'm mad. That's a joke. The more mature a person is, the more okay they are with expressing their anger. But there's another side to that. The more mature a person is, the more they're not going to sin in that anger. So here's the thing. We're given permission to express it, but not permission to sin in it. Anybody see that? So be angry, but do not sin. Now look at what he says. Do not let the sun go down on your anger. How is it that I can do that? How is it that I can be angry and not sin? Well, he says one way to do that is to make sure that you keep short accounts. In other words, what I'm trying to do as a believer in Christ, I'm trying to honor him by going through my day, and when I get angry, I see injustice, and believe me, I see injustice every day in what I do for a living. But here's the thing. By the end of that day, I want to be done with that. By the end of that day, I want to be done with that. Now listen to me carefully. There's some things that have hurt you deeply. I get it. Don't ever look up here at me and think I've never been hurt. That's not the truth. I've been hurt deeply, and it's been more than a day before I've been able to get rid of that. Sometimes it's been months. But my goal is that by the end of the day, I want to be done with it. And so if I'm still wrestling with it the next day, here's the thing. I'm still wrestling with it. I'm not just saying it's okay that I feel this way. Anybody with me? I'm still wrestling with it. I want to be done with it. My goal is to be done with it by the end of the day. Keep short accounts. Verse 27, what happens when you don't keep short accounts? When you don't try to get rid of your anger? You give an opportunity to the devil. So exactly what we've been talking about is exactly what happens. Why? How did I get where I got? I just decided to sit in my feelings. I just decided to sit in my hatred. I just decided to sit in my payback mode. I dwelt on that. It ate me up, but I was okay with it. I gave an opportunity to the devil, and what happened to me? It ruined my life. Anybody with me? Come on now. Are you with me? How do I deal with anger then? What do I do with it? If I'm supposed to get rid of it by the end of the day or work on it at least, what do I do with it? Look at this next verse. Romans 12:19. Key really helps us out here. Notice what he says. Beloved, that means those who have faith in Christ, those who have trusted Christ, that's beloved. In other words, you have no hope if you haven't put your faith in Christ. So do that today if you have not. But notice what it says. Never avenge yourselves. Never avenge yourselves. Are you seeing this? There's nothing that someone can do to you that makes it okay for you to take it out on them. Anybody see that? Never avenge yourself. Never. Look at what he says next. But leave it to the wrath of God. Leave it to the wrath of God. What am I doing there? Okay, here's what I'm doing. Watch. Somebody's hurt me. It's bad. I'd like to see him pay. What do I know about God? The most important thing that I know about God right now is this. He'll take care of it. Look at what he says. Leave it to the wrath of God. If I'm leaving it to somebody, that means I'm believing they're going to take care of it. Are you with me? I'm believing they're going to take care of it, so I'm leaving it to him. If I really have faith in the character of God and who he is according to God's word, then I know he's going to take care of it. For it is written, vengeance is mine. What does he say? I will repay, says the Lord. Is he going to forget what happened to you? Anybody with me? Is he going to forget it? No way. No way. He's going to take care of it. I will repay. That's what's in my heart. I want to see somebody pay. What do I need to do? Give that to God, because guess what? He's going to make sure they do. He's way better at that than you are. Here's one of the things that you need to remember while you're talking about that to God. What is it that I have done that needs payment? See, it's really hard for me to remember anything that I've done wrong when someone else has wronged me. Is that true of you? But here's the problem with that. I've hurt a lot of people. I've been calloused. I've been hard. I've been mean. I've been selfish. Uh-oh. This says it's his to repay that too. What about that? Here comes the guilt again. Here comes the shame again. I start thinking about my past and I can't even deal with it. Anybody with me? I better run to Jesus, because that's where that payment was made. That's what the cross is all about. Believe that God is just and He will make it right. The third thing that I want you to notice in this text is the rationalizations. So Samson has guilt. He's got premeditation. He's got this guilt that God is allowing him to have to slow him down so that he'll deal with God on these things. But watch this, don't miss this. Instead of letting God deal with him, instead of him running to God and saying, oh man, I've got this guilt, it's so heavy on me. Instead of him doing that, he rationalizes it and blows right past the guilt. Make sure you see that. There's a good many of us that are doing that. We're blowing right past the guilt. We're acting like it's not even from God. And we're trying to rationalize what we're doing. What are we talking about? We're talking about having good reasons for the wrong things we do. But I had a good reason. Look at what he says. Listen to the sentence again, verse 3. This time I shall be innocent in regard to the Philistines when I do them harm. What's he doing? He's rationalizing what he's about to do. Right? He's saying, I have a good reason to do the wrong thing. And it's allowing him to just plow right through the guilt. The guilt that is there for a good reason. Let's get this straight. You ready for this? No matter how many good things there may be, no matter how many good reasons there may be to do the wrong things, or how many bad ways there are to accomplish the right thing, no matter what there is out there for rationalizations, no matter, we are still responsible for obedience to God's word. Did you hear what I said? No matter how many rationalizations you can come up with, no matter how many good reasons to do the wrong thing, you're still responsible for obedience to God's word. See, God not only has a will, God has a way. So look at this. Here's the thing. That means that the ends never justify the means. In other words, look, God has a will and God has a way. So this is God's will that this happens, but I've also got to walk in His way as it happens. So here's the problem. We look at Samson. And here's the facts. We look at Samson and we look at his story, and God's plan was to destroy the Philistines. God's plan was to destroy the Philistines. Somebody say, I get that? That's what he wanted to have happen. But that does not exempt Samson from obedience to God's will. He's still personally responsible for his sin. So here's what you have. Listen close. Some of you are going to walk away with something very powerfully changed in your life here. Others of you are just going to know what the guy next to you said the whole time. But listen close. See, it means a lot to me that you get God's word. It means everything to me. So I will pound it home till there's nobody here. I will. You listen to me closely now. What this means is you take Samson, you put that on you, you listen close, and what happens is this. No matter what somebody does to me, no matter how bad things are, no matter what I want to see accomplished, no matter how bad my heart yearns for something to happen, I'm still responsible for obedience to God's word. Samson is responsible for his sin, even if he's accomplishing what God wants to accomplish in his will. Do you see it? So, Samson just plows forward through all of these things, through the guilt, through the premeditation, to the rationalizations, and he plows forward into revenge. Look at verses 4 and 5. So Samson went and caught 300 foxes and took torches, and he turned them tail to tail and put a torch between each pair of tails. And when he had set fire to the torches, he let the foxes go into the standing grain of the Philistines and set fire and attacked in the stacked grain and the standing grain as well as the olive orchards. So Samson just plows forward in revenge. The conditions there were extremely dry. The fire burned so fast nobody could stop it. The Philistine state was five cities around the outside with the farmland in the middle. He let the foxes loose, or actually jackals loose, in the center. And they went out burning the crops as they went. They're destroyed. The Philistines, if you get a handle on what's being said here, they're utterly ruined. Their economy is shot. Every crop that they have has been burnt, and they're utterly ruined. And so what we see is the Philistines have gathered together a council meeting at verse 6, and they ask, who has done this? And after some discussion, somebody who apparently was at the wedding and knows the whole story answers, Samson, the son-in-law of the Timnite, because he has taken his wife and given her to his companion. So they knew exactly why Samson did this. But what could they do? Here's the thing. The damage is already done. Are you with me? The damage is done. And so there's one thing that they can do. And now watch. The story gets literally heated up again right now. There's one thing that they can do. Verse 6. And the Philistines came up and burned her and her father with fire. So what we see here is that the Philistines burned, in retribution for their burnt crops, they burned Samson's wife and father-in-law to death. That's what they did. Now I want you to notice something as we get toward the end of this text and we finish up. Way back in chapter 14, follow with me because this takes a little bit to get a hold of. Way back in chapter 14, verse 15, during the wedding feast, the companions of Samson had threatened his wife. Remember what they did? They said, entice Samson to give the answer, or we will burn your house down. And apparently what they meant is, we're going to burn your house down with you in it. So way back at the wedding feast a year earlier, that's what they had threatened to do. And what happened was this. She did do exactly as they said. She enticed Samson. She dishonestly manipulated the answer out of him to save her own skin. Are you with me? That's what she had done. So she avoided that death back then, that threat back then. But notice what happens here. The death that she had sought to avoid by sinning and betraying her own husband now found its way to her. Here's what you need to understand. This is the fallacy of compromising to save your own skin. Are you getting your head around that? This is the mistake, the error of compromising to save your own life. What it is a physical picture of a spiritual truth. This is a physical picture of a spiritual truth. Let me show you what I'm talking about. Go over to the New Testament. Notice Matthew chapter 16, verse 24. Actually, look at verse 25 first and notice what it says. Whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever would lose his life for my sake, Jesus says, will find it. Let's do that one more time. Verse 25. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Loses his life for my sake will find it. So what we see there is this picture of exactly that taking place in Samson's life. She sells him out to save her own skin. And what happens? She actually loses her life for doing that. Anybody with me? Yeah, now take a look at the passage again and let's get into it. Watch this close. Jesus said to his disciples, he told his disciples, if anyone would come after me. So I want you to understand something. You've been in a church someplace. Listen, man. You've been in a church someplace where they said to you, just say this prayer and you'll be cool with God. Just, you know what? You know what? Just repeat after me and Jesus will come into your heart and everything is going to be whoopee-ding with God after that. I'm just a little angry with those churches. And I'll tell you something. That's not what the Bible says. Jesus said, if anyone would come after me, what does he need to do? One, deny himself. Two, take up his cross and follow me. Number three, do you see it? Anybody home? Listen close, man. Listen to what's being said here. You say a prayer. You think you're right with God because you said a prayer. And what he actually says is all you're going to do is try to save your life after that, and actually you're going to lose it. Unless you've actually given your life to Christ in such a way that from that point on, listen to me close, from that point on, you are denying yourself. See, it's not about my way anymore. It's not about getting things done for me anymore. It's not about the way I want my life anymore. It's about what Jesus wants for me. It's about his plan for me. It's not Jesus is a way for me to gain everything that I always wanted. What will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his own soul? Or what shall a man give in return for his own soul? What am I doing? When I give my life to Jesus Christ, I'm talking about, okay, I might say a prayer to start that out. But after that, every day is a matter of me denying myself and walking with Christ. Every day is a matter of me denying myself and following Christ. What if for your entire life you don't let anybody get the upper hand on you? What if for your entire life you're always the one that comes out on top? What if for your entire life you're always the tough one, the strong one, the one that makes sure everything goes your way? What if? What does it profit a man if he gains the whole world? Here's what happens. You've lost your soul. You've traded this world for the next. You decided this is the one I want right here. Samson is a perfect example of that. He's always seeking to save his own life, taking matters into his own hands. You notice at verse 7 as we finish up, Samson said to the Philistines who had burnt his wife and father-in-law to death, he said to them, if this is what you do, I swear I will be avenged on you, and after that I will quit. Let me encourage you to understand something this morning. There are a good many of us who are sitting here in churches this morning around the world, here today at North Park, who are saying, okay, I'm going to give my life to Christ one day when I'm good and ready. But I'm not ready to quit. I'm not ready to repent. I'm not ready to turn from whatever it is that God is saying. After that, I will quit. Then I might turn to Christ. After I do what I want, then I might turn to Christ. I wonder how many times that is actually acted out in our lives, and we kid ourselves into believing that we've really given our lives to Jesus. As I finish up, I'm just asking the Holy Spirit to fall on you right now, and listen to me closely. I pray that you would allow God to speak to you just one more minute and say to your heart, have I really surrendered my life to Christ? Have I really repented of my sins and turned to Jesus? What we're talking about, think about this, what we're talking about is this. That means that the God of the universe would move in and live inside of you. Don't you think things would be different? Have I really surrendered and allowed the God of the universe to live inside of me? Understand this, there's only one place throughout history where God's hatred of sin and his love for you come together. One place. That's the cross of Jesus Christ. That's where I need to come to. I need to repent of my sin, turn from it, turn to the cross of Christ, throw myself at the mercy of God, and say, save me. Come to Jesus today. Father, this morning we come to you, and there may be people here this morning, God. I believe we have prayed, we have asked you. I believe it's your will. Therefore, I believe that there are people here today. In each of our services this weekend, here today at this service, God, that people who are repenting of their sin and turning to you. Listen to me. As we pray, consider what God is doing. If you're listening, if you're listening to God's Spirit, not to this voice up here, but God's Spirit in it, you know that there's pride and there's all sorts of things that are keeping you from real submission to Christ. Throw it away. Toss it away. Be done with it. Let the Spirit of God crush you today. And turn from your sin. All of it. Not just the ones you choose to be done with, but everything. Your ideas, your ways of life, your hopes, turn from those things and turn to the hope of Christ. Jesus alone, it's his purpose, his plan. The cross of Christ is where he paid for your sin. Father, as we submit ourselves to you, we recognize that this is not just a momentary decision, God, but that from this point on, that means that I will put myself in places where I can grow in you, where I can understand more and more of your word. It means that you live inside of me and my heart has been changed in such a way, God, that my desire is for you, that I want to grow, God, to hate the things that you hate and love the things that you love. Father, I might need a whole new set of friends. Friends that love you. Do whatever you need to do in my life today, God, to make it yours. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.